was like, and it was like 10 o'clock at night, and I'd hiked out to these tops of these like pretty cool sandstone things, and I'm up there and I'm, you know, doing my thing.
Sure.
Half moon, beautiful reflections. And I took a shot, and suddenly the camera goes, error.
That's a movement, Captain.
Yeah, this is going to be like 20 episodes in, and it still seems like I'm learning how to do this whole
thing. Casting of pods.
Yes.
Yes.
Let's get some ambiance.
Ambiance.
Yeah. Well, you sound like you're freezing.
I'm not freezing. San Diego, it's nothing ever but warm.
Turning on something for a little bit of ambiance, a little lightsaber action going on.
Lightsaber. Look at that. Spencer's got all the toys.
Wow.
Great.
Whoops. Wrong white balance.
The force is broken.
There
in this
we are.
One.
Not our first ready. It's okay. Turn off the. I'm learning. Turn off the headlights in the car.
Yeah, no headlights. And maybe. I don't know. What about this?
Well, these lights are
going to. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm going to turn it off because it's going to turn off anyway.
Ah. Okay.
I don't even know that this light's moved on. Anything here? Ooh, glowy.
This part of the show is brought to you by Thomas Edison.
Or Tesla.
Well, I was just referring to light.
Oh, okay.
But anyway, yeah, Tesla did get it. Yeah. I don't mean the car, I mean the guy.
No, right.
Yeah, he got
the
a bum
inventor.
Rap. He got a bum rap.
Yeah, I did.
All right, so Spencer Pablo.
Hey, I'm Spencer Pablo.
He's Spencer Pablo. I'm Scott Davenport.
Hello, Scott. How are you, man?
We are photographers in cars.
Welcome to another episode. This is going to be...
Episode number something.
Yeah.
Because we record these and don't quite know exactly what order they're going to go up in.
I know.
That's how unscripted it is.
Mm.
So, here, little peel back of the curtain behind the scenes. 13 seconds ago, before we got in the car, said, we're going to talk about like keeping yourself safe when it's windy. Okay, let's go.
I was like,
that's basically
yes.
It.
Yeah.
Yeah, because we were both had our own, like, windy shoot conditions mm-hmm. in the last week. And we said, oh, well, then that seems to be something common. Let's talk about that.
Oh, yeah. We really are unscripted. I mean, we kind of have a board where we reflect, oh, yeah, I want to talk about that in some future episode at some point. But we don't really dive deeper into it until we start the episode.
It really is. It's really just, you know, if I were a comedian that had writers, I would say, do something about bumper stickers. And that's as much information that goes into like these lines of, you know, like, here's an idea. That's it.
Yeah.
So, which, you know, okay. You get 2 minutes of crap like this, but then hopefully you get some like, you know, epiphanies, revelations, or any other haughty
just,
words I can
that
think of.
That
just start to come out. Yep. Yeah. So, let's see. So we both had windy shoots.
Yeah. California was just like beat up with some wind the past couple of days. President's Day weekend. You can look it up.
Yeah.
We had a bunch of wind, and as for San Diego or for California, that was a lot more wind than I think we anticipated. I took video. I'm going to go ahead and share that video.
But oh, sure. Yeah.
Part of the freeway that we were driving on, just it looked like it was Martian. It was just like you couldn't see five cars in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
You can see five cars in front of you. The sand, because we drove by sand dunes, it was just covering the road, and our cars kept being pushed to one side.
Sure. And so before you were obviously driving in that, mm-hmm. you were out with the camera.
Yeah.
Now, was it that windy while you were shooting?
Oh, boy, was it. So I actually, another video, I was actually wanting to, both my wife and I, we wanted to fly drones over the sand dunes for the weekend, and we prepared.
In high winds.
Yeah. Well, we didn't realize. So we had all our batteries for our drones charged. We're like, yeah, I can't wait to fly it. And then we're out there. We're like, dude, it's 30 mile per hour winds with 50 mile per hour gusts.
Yeah.
You know? And so when the wind died down, and by dying down, I mean, it was maybe like 20 miles per hour. I remember Trisha took her little drone mm-hmm. and she powered it up, and it lifted, and then as soon as it was off the ground, it started to move, and she's like, nope, landing it.
Yeah.
Oh, it was rough. So it did.
So in that, it changed our trajectory. That, it's like that extreme example of you're keeping your stuff safe was not flying.
Yeah.
Just it's not like, well, I mean, I guess, you know, any drone crash, even if it's in sand, you know, something could get
blown. Oh, yeah.
But more likely just get blown so far off you wouldn't be able to find it.
Oh, yeah. So we didn't fly the drone as much, but we still had our gear. We still took DSLR photo or mirrorless photos, but one thing, because it was so windy, we just didn't change lenses. And we were like, hey, guess what? That lens, you know, if I wanted to put another lens, it should have been born on the camera. You know,
that's funny. Yeah, I had I had similar things. It was windy conditions. Yeah. It was during my Death Valley workshop.
Mm-hmm.
And there are two things that stand out to me. One was the, you know, the wind changes as the sun's rising or setting. You get that differential of temperature in the air. And so we're up at a couple of these points at elevation. And it's, you know, it's relatively calm. Things are okay. And then as soon as, in this case, it was sunrise. Sun starts coming up. The wind really starts blowing in from the east.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, so things were, you know, like you said, don't change lenses. And so most of the folks had either, really small mirrorless cameras. So if you had to change lens, you could kind of take your coat and just put your back to the wind and do a quick change and you were, pretty much good. Or you have a second body, you just change, everything's already mounted. You're just switching physical bodies.
Sure.
But something else was with our tripod positioning. So we're up on a kind of a ridge. And so taking the single leg of the tripod and putting that closest and most forward. So if you were to imagine the wind coming this way, I'd have my two legs here and one leg here. Which is almost counterintuitive, but if you have the two legs,
forward,
the opposite way, it's easier to tip the tripod. It's similar to if you're shooting on the side of a hill. You don't want the two going downslope. You want one going downslope, and it's really, you tap on it with two going downslope, you tip it right over. You don't even need much at all,
dude. So that, realize that until right now. But that makes
sense. It's a major deal. You know, of course, then also hanging our bags.
Yeah.
Anything else that you can do to kind of just give some downward, weight to the tripod, holding it in place.
That I've done. It was windy, but you know what? A couple of months ago, I went up to Monterey and around the Carmel by the Sea area, we were on our way to go see McWay Falls to go check it out and experience it in person. But I had no idea it was going to be that windy. And I remember, I saw a really cool shot. There's this bridge. I want to take a long exposure shot, but I want to take lots of long exposure shots. It wasn't a time lapse, but it was the Sony a7R III does this thing called the pixel shift. And I wanted to take a bunch of those shots where it moves the pixel.
You get some super, super resolution and really fine detail.
Yeah.
And like an architecture shot, like a bridge.
But
then the rest of it, you can let be soft.
So I wanted to do that. But it was so windy that my really heavy tripod started to shake. And I was like, wow, this is ridiculous. So then I hung my backpack on it. Mm-hmm. And it was so cold. I actually was... the wind was just... The wind was beating me up. So I actually found protection from this boulder that I just kind of hunched over. Mm-hmm. And my back was to it while I'm holding my tripod legs, making sure it felt like I was, it felt like one of those war scenes. I imagine myself in a war scene and there's gunfire and I'm hiding behind a rock. And
right.
It was wind and it was just beating me up. And I was holding the tripod legs, making sure that it wouldn't move, making sure I wasn't moving it. But yeah, the wind is just, it's, as much as I love weather, the wind is just the one thing that I'm like.
Well, I still look relatively, I don't know how well it's going to look in this. I'm like relatively red, and it's mostly windburn. It's mostly windburn. It's not sunburn.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So it was, the particularly Death Valley, desert does a number on you. So the other situation we had out there was, we're out on one of the areas of the flats, north of Badwater, and same thing happens, sunset starts to come in, the wind starts changing, and then we're just watching the basin fill in with dust. Because it's just starting to slowly creep forward. Thankfully, the sun had gone over the ridge, we got some good shots, and we're looking like, yep, there's not going to be any more sunset here. And, that's some nasty stuff. I mean, besides being sand, it's borax and what other chemicals are out there. So something that, we were all doing to help protect the front element of our lenses.
Oh, yeah.
I had, at that point, I'd switched to a longer lens. So I had the big long hood on it. So using your lens hood helps a little bit. But anytime you weren't actively shooting, covering up the front element, even if it's your lens cap, I use these, you know, stretchy covers from Lens Coat.
A little boot looking thing I've seen you
use. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I got those because of a totally different reason, but they were really handy for keeping the front element safe. And, you know, anything to, you know, not keep the camera open, definitely not changing lenses.
That so point. You don't use like UV filters or anything like that?
I don't. Okay. And you know, I've gone back and forth on them, you know, as far as, you know, do I use them? Do I not use them? I had to have
them. No, I belong to the school where I will use a UV filter because I have dropped too many lenses. The UV filter will sacrifice itself instead of the.
I've only dropped a filter.
Okay. Yes.
And we know about
that. Oh, so sad.
So I've not had any other, you know, issues like that. But, yeah, I mean, you know, and, you know, for a windy situation, that's, you know, I could see myself changing my tune and saying, I'd want one of those just sheerly for the fact of let the UV filter take all of the, you know, grit and sand and so forth.
So I've also noticed, cause now I'm shooting more and more with square filters than I've done before because I can't use the apps on the smooth reflection app, which is so cool. I can't use them on the new cameras because it's not a thing that's built into it anymore. Yeah. So I'm using square filters and I'm noticing if the wind is coming at me, the square filters just have this huge sail weight. And because of the sail weight, the camera is just more susceptible to being pushed by the wind. And I've seen it ruins. I've seen it ruin a few of my time lapses or a few of my long exposures just because the wind's been beating down. But, you know, at that point, you're just like, well, I'm photographing nature. Nature's sometimes going to rear its face like that. I'm not going
to
go like,
yeah, exactly. There's only so much you can do. I mean, I suppose you could try to simulate it and just take a bunch of shots and then go blame yourself later.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, that's fundamentally what that app was doing in camera. And
yeah,
you know, if you got one shot that's fuzzy, throw it away.
Yeah. But as you know, sometimes if the lighting is so sweet, sometimes that lighting only lasts a few seconds, you know, and if you want to capture that light.
And if you're taking 64 photos, then you'll get one of them.
I'm
failing to see the problem there.
So if I'm taking a bunch, you have to do that from the beginning. You have to know then that you are going to take the 64 frames and then make a
Hang on a second. Unpack this for me here. So you were talking about I'm putting a pretty heavy piece of glass on the front and that's going to be catching wind. So I'm a little worried about that. But I put that heavy piece of glass on front. I was going to take a 5 second exposure, a 50 second exposure. What I mean?
So yeah, I was going to take a 3 minute exposure.
Okay. Well, now I don't want to do that because of the wind. Well, but I still want the effective look of a 3 minute exposure. Well, then I'm going to take umpteen individual exposures and blend them together. Well, I'm already doing that. So aren't I going to catch that 3 seconds?
Well, no. Anyway? So watch this, right? So. Okay. Here's this beautiful skyline. The cloud is over here, and you know the wind direction is going to make this cool, like this leading line into your city. Mm-hmm. Well, you're taking a long exposure shot, and then all of a sudden, and as time goes by, that cloud, I'm blocking ACAM.
Sorry.
That cloud is like halfway through your frame. And then all of a sudden you just lost that shot. Now you have to start taking your 64 frames, but that cloud that you so badly wanted to help do that leading line is halfway through your frame.
I guess I don't see the fundamental difference in knowing when I need to start my 3 minute exposure versus when I'm going to start my sequence.
So if you start your sequence back here where that's how come I said you have to begin. You have to begin your 64 frames,
right,
or whatever the number, right? You have to begin your frames knowing that you're going to be taking not a long exposure shot, but you're going to be taking 64 frames. And sometimes you're taking 3 minute shots and you're like, oh, this breeze, I've experienced this breeze before. It doesn't mess up my shot. And then all of a sudden, oh, wow, gusts are happening, you know? And so while you're taking that 3 or 4 minute shot, the conditions are changing. And because they're changing, now you have to adapt. You have to stop your long exposure shot, and then you're like, okay, now I have to start taking 64 frames. But at that point, if you start taking your 64 frames, the cloud that you wanted to capture is now not where it's at.
Okay, I understand what you're saying. So you're having to change
right
in the middle of your long exposure.
Right.
I was thinking in terms of I've recognized that this is a problematic situation.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the thing is, in that, in your scenario, I don't know if there's a win. Because you started and then the conditions change and start whipping up, horrible winds. Well, all right, my long exposure is ruined.
Yeah,
I could compensate and start with the shorter things. But you know what? It's going to start whenever it starts.
No, it's true.
You're just stuck at that point. You know, there's only and that happens. You know, sometimes you're not going to get what you'd envisioned, and that's okay.
And you go back to that one episode where we talk about sometimes you just don't get the shot.
Oh God, yeah, the cameras didn't even come out of the bag.
Yeah,
I think that was the title of the episode. Yeah. Something about cameras and bags.
So, but that's how come you lose a shot, you just come back. If that's an option.
Well, I mean, it's sometimes you lose a shot. It's just how it goes.
Yeah.
You know, but okay. Yeah. Thank you, though. Now I understand the scenario. Yeah. It's like, I'm not.
Yeah.
I got two and two here, but I'm not getting
four. If all things were the same,
yeah,
you could change midway through and start taking your 64 frame shots. But as we all know, especially when you do time lapse, you do those long exposure.
Yeah. There'll be a gap. I mean, you know, you could fill it in with the tools as best you can.
Yeah.
You know, it's only us photographers that would notice anyway. I mean,
oh man,
it's so true. Yeah.
so the wind, wind is something, and I've also done shots where it's beautiful. And it actually happened this morning where things look good and and all of a sudden there's rain that happens. And you're just like, what there, how is there rain? Because it happened this morning.
Right.
The rain started coming down and I'm looking, I'm like, that does not look like a rain cloud. Why is my windshield wiper going? Why is it raining on me? It really didn't feel like it was going to rain today.
Yeah.
So I've had that happen when I'm taking pictures too. And so you're just going to get all these different things that happen that will change the trajectory of what you're going to do.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think rain conditions, I don't have to shoot in rain very often.
Yeah.
It's a curse of San Diego. But, that ones I think are, somewhat more obvious. You get, a simple rain sleeve.
Yeah.
If you're in a pinch, you use the shower cap from a hotel room if you're traveling, or, a plastic bag or something. And you wipe down the front of your lens a lot. It's like, actually, for me, it'd be more like shooting at waterfalls.
Yeah.
You get a lot of, or even at the beach. You get a fair amount of spray on a particularly, choppy surf day, you get a lot of
that's where spray I've actually in the seen air. You use your boot.
And so, you wipe stuff off, you put the boot back on when you're not shooting. Anything to just keep, gunk, particulates in the air, whether it's dust, salt spray, waterfall spray, just, cover things up. What else? What other? I mean, I don't have enough. I don't have enough horror stories from weather. Just,
California.
I don't shoot in snow, so
it's
It's
not even weather all the time. Sometimes it's a car that just drives by in a quiet area that you've never seen a car for hours, and all of a sudden a car with their bright headlights come at you and then ruin that, 3 minute shot.
Oh well, yeah. I mean, there's plenty of examples of how to ruin shots. I was thinking more in terms of situations where you need to protect your gear, or in that case, protect yourself. Being cognizant of what's going on around you, or you're in a quiet area and then suddenly there's someone just comes barreling through.
So with that, again, I'm gonna go back to the trip in Monterey. There was a cool shot. I wanted to do star trails, and I knew and I planned on there being some cars just coming by, even though cars didn't come by.
Right.
And what I did to compensate for that was I placed my vehicle in the way to block light.
From the position where the camera was.
Okay, I anticipated that there would have been, some shots that were going to be ruined by headlights. So that's like my car ended up blocking that. But there was a car that's like, I'm going to go drive at the beach real fast. And then that's the one that I just didn't anticipate. And I was like, but the beach is right in front of my lens.
So that's funny. It seems like a rite of passage, like one of the things you end up trying as a landscape. I want to do star trails. And
right.
Obviously, this is like three plus years ago. And you can do star trails even in a city. You're going to get ambient, noisy light, but you can still get some trails. I was out at Torrey Pines Beach, and I decided to shoot in a certain direction. And, the cars go by every once in a while, but it was 2 a.m, so it was just every once in a while.
Yeah.
They ended up light painting the lifeguard tower for me. And it
was
a happy accident.
Just because
instead of doing like one huge long exposure, I'll do a sequence and stitch them together. So you get, for me, I think I got more flexibility. I can throw away the bad frame that didn't work. And that ended up just, you know, it's like, oh yeah, mental note, you know, kind of position myself with my back to the flow of, at least the predominant flow of traffic.
Okay.
And, yeah, that kind of worked out.
So it's cool. Yeah. Cause I mean, we're actually showing, okay, hey, here's the wind. How do you compensate for the wind? Here's a slope. How do you compensate for a slope with your tripod? Have you ever had an issue where you forget an SD card or battery or something like that? Has that ever...
I actually haven't. I've not forgotten a battery.
Photographer.
Now, I've had an SD card go bad on me in the middle of a shoot, and I had a spare. You know, and it was like I was in Portugal. So I was and miles and miles away from any camera store.
There was no Best Buy that it was just like right
no
there.
No Best Buy. But it was it was like 10 o'clock at night, and I'd hiked out to these tops of these like pretty cool sandstone things. And I'm up there and I'm, you know, doing my thing.
Sure.
Half moon, beautiful reflections. And I took a shot and suddenly the camera goes error. I'm like, oh crap. You know, so you have like this 4 seconds of, oh my God. You know, I'm in this great spot.
Yeah.
And it's like, all right, pause. Turn off the camera, you know, find the spare, put it in and say, I'm going to worry about that later. You know, and thankfully it was, you know, one shot that got lost. Yeah. Everything else on the card was fine. And, you know, just continued on. But no, I mean,
wow.
I think the way I avoid that is everything's always in my bag. You know, I get back from a shoot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the cameras will come out, the batteries go on the charger, the SD cards get downloaded to a machine. And as soon as the download's done, the card goes back in.
Okay.
And, you know, if for any reason I forgot the three batteries that are in three different chargers somewhere throughout the office, there's six other batteries in my bag still.
Yeah.
So, you know, I would have to forget the cameras for it to become, you know, a problem.
Okay. Yeah. So my problem is I have about eight different bags, and I'll get them based on... I'll change my bags based on what I'm shooting. So if I'm going on a trip around Europe, I'm going to bring the kitchen sink, right? And so it's going to be the big bag, and
it's actually shaped like a sink.
But if I'm going to go photograph a family, I'm going to bring my 35 millimeter, my 55, and possibly my 90. And so it's not a lot of stuff. So I'll use my small messenger bag, but I have to remember in every one of these bags, I have to have like three batteries and an SD card and stuff like that. And sometimes I'll exhaust my spare supplies without replenishing them. And that freaks me out. And so that's,
So you have immensely more equipment.
Yeah. I overcomplicate my life.
I have everything I own, sort of the tripod fits in like one of those Urban Explorer 15 inch backpacks.
Dang.
I might be pushing that now. I'm trying to think. When I traveled last, did I fit everything in there? I don't think I did, because I've got four bodies, including the 6,000 now.
Okay.
But you know, predominantly everything I own could fit in that. And so the only time I ever switch a bag is if I'm flying. I'll put everything into that thing because I can just carry it on. I know there's never an issue.
Sure.
And then from that point forward,
yeah. That's
so
cool.
So that is easier for me. The battery's all. Go across all the cameras I have, so that part's cool.
Yeah,
you know. So yeah, I'm definitely much more minimal when it comes to stuff.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's so nice. I miss those days.
Yeah,
well. I do. But I'm a tech guy, so I'm a gear guy. You know what? I need that 100 or 400 because of the one or two times a year that I actually need that range.
Yeah.
I need to have that lens. So yeah, there's
if I only had one more millimeter, I'd feel so much more comfortable.
Oh, man. So there's no, I don't think there's a bag that I have that can contain all the stuff.
Well, you have a vast variety of things. Like you used the cross-train term before. So there's a reason you have different bags. There's a reason you have different gear. And you wouldn't want to bring all that stuff on, you know. That's like another one of those rites of passage, right, for photographers. I'm going on this big trip. I'm bringing everything I got. And you got like two hard cases full of stuff, and 80% of it stays in the case, and you know, you don't end up using it all.
Yeah.
So I think being a little more light.
I think so on a future episode we actually need to talk about I think a lot of people think I'm a gear guy, but I try to balance practicality as well. It's mm-hmm. it's weird how much stuff I have, but what you don't see is me actually talking myself as well as others down from actually buying some stuff.
I don't see that side of you at all, because it seems like every other day it's like, hey, so-and-so's having a 50 bucks off of this thing.
Oh.
And, you know.
Well, so I
just bought 5 things on Kickstarter and I got 9 more lenses showing.
I don't know why I love Kickstarter so much. So that's one thing. But I mean, if you think about it, I shoot the Sony A7 R2 or the A7 R3 they're mirrorless bodies and they use what's called the E-mount system.
Yep.
And I get a lot of folks saying, hey, you need to go full E-mount. You know, full E-mount, because I don't have any more A-mount cameras, which was the bigger Sony DSLR or DSLT style. Mm-hmm. I still have A-mount lenses. Mm-hmm. And people are like, why do you have that? There's an E-mount equivalent. And well, the person in me that says, oh yeah, you need to go upgrade all the time, isn't there. It's like, dude, this 70 to 200 f2.8 is A-mount, yes. And if you move it to E-mount, that's $2,500, I think.
Right.
It's $2,500, and what does that get you?
Maybe a second faster on a focus, maybe, yeah, or something
IAF and stuff like that. But my shooting style doesn't have that, and I have an adapter.
That's good. I mean, I'm the champion of that stuff.
You know, yes, you are.
You need a problem to solve if you go and get more gear. Short of it being, well, I just like gear. And I want to have that. And that's it. That's totally fine. Because your problem to
now,
solve
I know
is,
some people who something. Are like that. I know some people who are.
Oh, sure.
Who will actually buy some stuff and it'll sit there unused for a long time.
But, you know, that's the thing. I mean, if you got the funds for it and you like getting the new techie thing, whatever, totally cool. You know, I'm never going to, you know, blame anybody for that.
Thanks
that's
for
totally
spreading
fun.
The economy. Totally.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I got some stuff you might want to buy too. Got a used gear shelf. Yeah. But yeah, for the, I would say the majority of us that don't have unlimited funds, it's got to solve a problem.
Right.
Yeah. We really drifted off from the
we did.
Wind topic.
Wind.
The
How
wind
did we do
blew
this?
Us off course. And there's a,
I see what you did there.
Tidal twirly low pressure system.
Yeah.
I'm running out of weather analogies here.
Man, we gotta work on, well, I definitely have to work on my dad jokes or my, that whole thing.
You know, I don't know. It seems sometimes it's harder when you're in the moment. We're actually having a lively conversation as opposed to sift. What the hell is that? We're having a lively conversation. That's what she said. That's really not good.
No, you said something about being hard.
No, I didn't.
Okay, wow.
Well, maybe I did. I don't know.
Man.
I'll have to rewind this and check.
Okay. Well, I think the wind has...
That's not a dad joke. That's not a dad joke. The wind failing of our sails, that's a dad joke. I have no more wind in my sails for this episode.
Oh.
Yeah, that's a dad joke.
We were all over the place. The wind was just like...
If you hear that noise... That's us scraping bottom. I think we're done.
I think we are done. Let's bail, go.
See you, everybody.
Good timing, too, because my camera finished.
Did it just finish? Oh, that's cool.